Please, you may be comfortably seated. I welcome you again to this most refreshing day in the name of Jesus. All through the week, we have been looking at our exhortation line. What must we know, knowing what to do to qualify for his reward? Knowing what to do to qualify for his reward. What must we do to qualify for his reward? And some of the highlights of what God opened our eyes to during the teaching in the week is, number one, that God's reward is full. God's reward is full. In Ruth chapter 2 and verse 12. Ruth chapter 2 and verse 12. God's reward is full. The Lord recompense thy work, and a full reward he given thee of the Lord, God of Israel, under whose wing thou art come to trust. So God's reward is full. You work in some establishment. Sometimes, maybe because of some problems, they give you half salary and push the rest to next year and keep paying small, small. But God is not like that. His reward is full. So if you must command God's full reward, then you must go full length with him. Number two, we also saw that God's reward is timely. God does not come late. In Revelation chapter 22 and verse 12, he says, "Behold, my reward is with me. Behold, I come quickly." Can I hear you say quickly? Come on, say it like somebody who is alive. "And my reward is with me to give every man according as his word shall be. Behold, I come quickly." So God's reward is timely. In Galatians chapter 6 and verse 9, he said, Be not weary, therefore, in well-doing. For in due season you shall reap if you faint not. In due season, God's reward is timely. When you are due, you will never be denied. Number three, we also establish the fact that God's reward is unlimited. God's reward is unlimited. Man's reward is limited to what he can see in the open. But God's reward is not so. It captures whatever he sees you do with your heart, both in the secret and in the open. And he rewards you accordingly. Men may not see what you do in the secret. You wake up in the midnight, your pastor is not there, your cell leader is not there, your unit leader is not there. But it's a commitment that you have taken with God. You pray for the kingdom. Outside all the corporate outreaches, you have personal time that you launch out with your wife or with your children or alone to still go forth and speak to souls. Nobody may see it, but God sees it. And in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 6, he said, "The God that sees in secret shall reward you openly." So God's reward is unlimited. It's not limited to only to what you do in the open. It captures everything that you do. What therefore must we do to qualify for his reward? What must we do? Understanding what you must do is what gives you access. When you understand, you take advantage of the time. In 1 Chronicles chapter 12 and verse 32, 1 Chronicles chapter 12 and verse 32, the Bible talks about the children of Issachar. He said they were people who had understanding of the time, and they know what Israel ought to do. They were not many, as it were. They were just 200. But all their brethren were at their command. They were in charge. Why? Because they understood the time and the season. This is a prophetic season. People who therefore know what to do, they connect to their prophetic blessing. So it's a strange season. It's a strange season that we must take full advantage of. Some people are whiling away time. Some people are seeing the whole exercise as, is this not too much or so? But people who have understanding, like the children of Issachar, they understand that it is a prophetic season, that they only need to position themselves to tap into their own personal breakthroughs. Praise the name of the Lord. What must we do, therefore, to qualify for this reward? Number one, we must continue to endure the demands of praying kingdom advancement prayer and passionate pursuit of souls. The key word there is to continue and to endure. We must continue. We must continue. We must continue to endure the demand of praying kingdom advancement prayers. And we must engage continuously, passionately after souls. Every great thing in life will always go with a demand. There can be no price without a price to pay. Every great thing that you get in life, it will cost you something. Anything that does not cost you something will never give you anything. It is always pain before gain. It is always pain before gain. So you need the spirit of endurance. If you don't endure, you can't enjoy. It is always pain before gain. And the issue is this: the closer you are to your breakthrough, the more the pain. Look at, for instance, a woman who is to give birth. When a woman is pregnant, first month, second month, no problem, third month, you know, and all. As the pregnancy begins to advance, she begins to feel some certain pains. Especially when she's due, almost due for delivery. The closer she is to delivery, the more the pain. In fact, the labor pain begins. I had an experience many years ago with one of our pastors that we are serving together. It was a forced pregnancy. And so the woman, coupled with the father, she was also a bit afraid because of certain things she has heard from different places. And then it was time for her delivery. And then the labor pain started. In fact, the husband, I had to tell the husband to go somewhere. Because that day, as the time progresses, the more the pain, the more the shout. And at a point in time, the names that we never knew that her husband and her father was bearing, we had it that day because of the pain. Praise the name of the Lord. And we quickly were rushing her, and we had to pass through the house of one of our deaconess who was a matron, so that she could go with us to the hospital. And as we got to our house, she delivered there. They took her delivery. And immediately after the delivery, there was a long sleep, a long rest. And by the time we returned, in fact, when she was sleeping like a baby, as if it was not the woman that was shouting some 20 minutes ago. And by the time she woke up, she now started with the husband talking about who does the child resemble. All the pains have been forgotten. Praise the name of the Lord. Just before your reward, there will be pain. But if you can endure, you are entering into your rest. Did I hear a loud amen? Did I hear a loud amen? Amen? Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1 to 2. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1 to 2. Wherefore, seeing we are encompassed with a great witness, he says, let us, you know, look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the shame. He despised the cross. For the joy that he said, for the reward that is ahead, it requires that we endure. Without enduring, there is no enjoyment. Praise the name of the Lord. So Satan will do everything to make you give up. Satan will do everything to get you wearied off. Because he knows the great reward is just by the corner. You have watched football before. Whenever a goal is about to be scored, everybody is under tension. The player, the commentator, the spectator, everybody. He takes the ball, he moves. Even the person who is not on the field is under tension. Until the goal is scored, no, before the tension disappears. So when you are about hitting your reward, there will be all manners of temptation to get weary. Satan wants you to lose your reward, but you will not lose your reward in the name of Jesus. What must we do? Number two, we must continue to despise the shame. We must continue to despise the shame. Mark chapter 8 and verse 38. If you are ashamed of him, he will be ashamed of you. Whosoever is ashamed of me in this adulterous and sinful generation, I will be ashamed of him. If you cannot bear his shame, he cannot eradicate your shame. If you cannot carry his reproach, he cannot terminate your own reproach. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10, he says, let us, if we labor and suffer reproach with him, then we enjoy the glory. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10. So let us carry the reproach. Let us carry the shame. People may mock you. People may say all manners of things. Despise it. The glory is coming. The reward is coming. Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus, for it is the power of God unto salvation to them that believe. Romans chapter 1 and verse 16. If you will stand with God, you will not lose your reward in the name of Jesus. Number three, we must continue to make ourselves of no reputation. No reputation. Put down your reputation. Just like we see our Father here, always there on outreach. So if our Father is there on outreach, what kind of reputation do you carry now that you cannot lay it aside for Jesus? Let us leave whatever we think is our achievement and go out there for the King of Kings to go and bring in souls. That is what glorifies him. If what is in his heart is what is in your heart, he will launch you higher than where you are in the name of Jesus. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 5. Hallelujah. Let us lay down our reputation. Let us lay down our reputation. Let us, you know, serve God with meekness of heart. God resists the proud. He gives more grace to the humble. For blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Whatever position you think you may have, lay it down. The greatest title that you can carry is a soul winner. As we launch out to the field again this morning, I see the angels go ahead of us, and I see the name of Jesus glorified. Rise up on your feet. Receive grace for continuity. Lord, I receive grace for continuity. Lift up your voice, receive grace. Lord, I receive grace for continuity. I will not be weary in my assignment. I will not be weary in soul winning. Wave your hands unto the Lord and give him praise. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying.